एंड आई थिंक नाउ वी आर लाइव ऑन फेसबुक। गुड इवनिंग एवरीबडी एंड वेलकम टू टुडेज सेशन। एंड टुडे वी हैव अ वेरी रिनाउंड हिस्टोरियन एंड अ वेरी स्पेशल गेस्ट प्रोफेसर टी के सुब्रमण्यम सर। ही हैज ऑलरेडी प्रेजेंटेड मैनी इंटरेस्टिंग लेक्चर्स ऑन कारवान एंड वी हैव द ऑनर अगेन टू होस्ट हिम टुडे टू स्पीक ऑन अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक दैट इज द ट्रेंड्स इन विजयनगर हिस्टोरिकल स्टडीज। Professor T.K.V. Subramanian was born in the year 1947 in Tirunelveli district of Tamil Nadu. He completed his Masters of Arts in History from Presidency College, Madras in 1968 and was awarded the Doctorate in History from Madras University in 1979. Having served as an assistant professor and professor under Tamil Nadu Collegiate Education System, at the postgraduate level from 1971 to 84, he joined the University of Delhi as a reader in 1984 and became a professor in the department in 1994. With a teaching and research experience for more than 41 years, Professor Subramanian has made significant contribution to the discipline of history through his continuous endeavors to explore the different facets of South Asian, South Indian history. He inherited the spirit of academic inquiry, reasoning, and critical thinking, and also dedication for its accomplishment from his father, Professor T.K. Kuppuswamy, and continued the tradition of music in the family. Today, as I said, he's going to speak on the trends of Vijayanagar historical studies. Towards the end of the session, we'll be taking questions from the audience around the subject. So feel free to send your questions through Facebook live chat and we'll be taking that in the Q&A session. So without further ado, I would request Professor Subramanian to take over and we'll meet after the lecture. Thank you so much, sir.
Good evening and happy 2021 to everybody. I'm happy to remind myself and also my people who I'm in interacting, that every new year in the millennium brings some new thoughts which we think that should is relevant to the times. So when I say 2021, I'm not tired of repeating what I said in the earlier lectures also. We are living in a knowledge society, and a teacher is a knowledge worker, and he is also expected to manage knowledge systems that way, even though he may be teaching whichever discipline that he is doing. So in that spirit, I also mentioned last time that we generate knowledge as researchers. As teacher, we are supposed to generate knowledge ourselves and transmit knowledge generated by others. And then as students, you are supposed to consume what is being generated. In that sense, I defined last time also knowledge production, pedagogy, and the discipline of history becomes important for me as a student, as a teacher of history who has taught for so many years. That's my real concern. And you know that the English word history is derived from the Greek word historia, which has three or four meanings. It means inquiry, it means research, it means exploration, and to me, these days, it would mean information also. I would like to add this sense also. So in studying history, it is vital to understand the distinction between history and the past. So there is a feeling, and people like Arthur Marwick, they have written that history and past float independent of each other. So I don't want to go into that kind of a debate, but I want to convey that history is a form of knowledge just as sciences as forms of knowledge. It is in that sense, it is there in a university system. It is in that sense, we teach it at a higher level. And when a historian handles information, he is different from others. When a historian handles information, he is faced with certain kind of questions which our earlier historians and those who practice history, they have defined it as source. So once the information is available, a historian puts certain questions. Who constructed the information? What is the purpose behind that construction? How and why it was constructed? And when that information passes through different generations, how each generation perceived and edited that information. So in that sense, we are interested in seeing how the information is converted into a tangible form of historical knowledge. This is what a student of history or a teacher of history is primarily concerned with. And in the course of evolution of history, information available at a particular point of time has gone through several kinds of societies as well. There were societies which perceived it in terms of property and labor. There were societies which perceived it as owners and non-owners. There were societies which perceived it as a laboring society. And we went through information society. Now we are in a knowledge society. So this is in that sense that information which is available at a particular point of time, it is passing through several generations, and a historian is now putting the question, the kind of questions which are raised. So that means a practitioner of history is compelled to deal with variety of sources where information is available and develop appropriate methodologies and a working definition, which I gave in the case of Bartenstein. Bartenstein's working definition of social formation was different from that of the Marxian definition of social formation. And there is also a debate. History has no object of study. No, history should have an object of study now if it is to claim social science. So today, if you ask me, my object of study is City of Victory or Vijayanagar. So in fact, I promised Ishan that let me begin the new year with a City of Victory so that we'll make that as an object of study. So now, when you say Vijayanagar, we mean Hampi. And how this Hampi could be studied? What are the sources of information? So if I give you a list, the sources, an ordinary person will say, why I need all these things? But unfortunately, if you want to know your heritage, if you want to know proper history of your the past, a student and a teacher at the higher level of learning has to spend time on your sources of information. That's why even in older books, you will find the very first thesis also, they have to say, these are the sources of my information. This is how I have analyzed it. These are the questions that I have posed. These are the answers that I have found. A thesis also takes that kind of a shape. So please give me 2 minutes. If I give you the names of sources and the people, then you will yourself appreciate why not many people are working on Vijayanagara. Because you have to deal with several languages, including foreign languages. And if you finally make it to, say, a place like Bijapur, very few theses have come on Bijapur because of the problem of handling languages in which the information is available. So I will give you a quick list of what a historian can get from these people. You know that broadly the Vijayanagara period is taken as 1350 to 1550, although 1565, only 15 years. I will come back to that. How this information enters a textbook, how this information is handled. I would like to add one more category of book, toolbook, textbook, toolbook, and then research. I will treat it at three levels. Who treats this information? How? That is what a historian, that's why I said in a question to Ishan, I said, I only consider two kinds of histories, good history and bad history. And there is no category for me. How good it is, how bad it is, that is my judgment. So if you post question for City of Victory, the first person to talk about it was a Moroccan scholar, Ibn Battuta. There is a certain specific date in which he visited, 1350s, 1360s. Then the Italian merchant, Niccolo Conti, 1469. Then the Russian merchant, Athanasius Nikitin. Then the Persian court chronicler, Abdul Razak. Then the Italian traveler, Ludovico Vartima. Then the Portuguese officer, Duarte Barbosa. Then Domingo Paes and Fernão Nunes. Then Tariki Ferishta, a Bijapuri historian Ferishta, and Barhani Mazir by Syed Ali Tabadaba. Besides this, you have Telugu poetry, because I'm going to come back to that a little later. Cultural creativity was at its height in my study. So you have Telugu poetry in the form of Raya Vachakamu, Manu Charitramu of Bedanna, Parijada Abharanamu of Timmanna, Krishnadevaraya's Amuktamalyata. Besides this, you have archaeological remains, multilingual inscriptions, genealogies, local kaifiyats, folk songs, oral verses, popular legends. See, you may ask whether a student of history who is doing PhD in 3 years is supposed to master all this. That is the reason why people don't come easily for this. It's a very difficult period to work on. So if you're working on limited inscriptions, that will give an image which will be questioned by some other source. So corroboration is very, very important when you are having multiple sources. So I have listed, this is the range from which information is available. So suppose you take the first person, I consider him the first person who said it is Nilkanth Shastri. We discussed last time why chapter 6 to 16, it is politico-military, one succeeded the other, so-and-so's date, renal period, this and that. That's a kind of a format. The person who set the format was Robert Sewall. Last time I gave you the other works, calendar, etc. But this time, we will take Robert Sewall's work. That is, in my opinion, is the benchmark study for Vijayanagar. So people have been generating information. Travelers have come. Travelers' accounts were coming. And these administrators were collecting all these things. And then the first person to see the ruins was another Italian traveler, Federici. He came 2 years after the Battle of Talaikota. 1565 was Battle of Talaikota. So I will come back to that, how the idea developed. But 1900, it was actually Robert Sewall who wrote The Empire. I mean, gave a very interesting title to that, A Forgotten Empire. He said it's a forgotten empire. A contribution to the history of India. I mean, it also has a subtitle. If you take the book published in 1900, luckily it was reprinted because after 50 years, you don't need a copyright. So luckily this has also come, it is available. And contribution to the history of India, London, the original one was published from London. And this, very interestingly, any book will have errata at the last. The book starts with corrections. The book starts with corrections. Very, very interesting. And where from Nilkanth Shastri got this idea of attaching the inscriptions to the work? It is started by this gentleman. Paes and Nunes chronicles collected from the Portuguese settled at Goa was actually appended to this book in 1900. You can see that. So if you go through the contents, so it is very, very interesting. And where from you get this idea of, I mean, what we generally call as a communal comment? It started with him. Introduction, he starts, a Hindu bulwark against Mohammedan conquest. Whether it is what I can say, it is a statement, whether he understood it as Hindu and Muslim, etc. But he has described it as a Hindu bull, very introduction itself, Hindu bulwark against Mohammedan conquest. No wonder. Krishnaswamy Iyengar, who wrote next, says, South India and her Mohammedan invaders. You know, somebody starts it and somebody takes it. You know, it's a kind of a format that is applied to other dynastic formations and studies, etc. Then interestingly, the kind of questions they put, this is what, because some students and some colleagues of mine, I said, so don't just make it a survey, make it with historiographical insights. So it is in that sense, some of these books I will go into slightly into detail to understand. So please forgive me if I am little taking a little more time than necessary. Those who have read it, they know it. So there is a certain approach in 1900 in producing a narrative on a city of history, I mean, a city of victory like Vijayanagar. Chapter 2, Origin of the Empire. So you will find this format everywhere. Origin of Pallavas, origin of this, historicity of Ram Gupta. When I was giving civil service exams, almost that question was certain. Discuss the historicity of Ram Gupta. So that question of historicity and the problems that were there, that was made as a question. Then chapter 3 is First Kings, 1336 to 1379. So same pattern, Nilkanth Shastri followed, Parantaka, this, that, year, Kulothunga, like that. You know that pattern, 1800 to 1950, there is a certain pattern of writing the history of a dynasty. That's what I am highlighting. Chapter 4, Growth of the Empire. Even now I saw another advertisement, Rise, Growth and Fall. Rise, Growth, Decline. You know, that again a kind of a pattern. Causes, course, results. That's again a any event. Causes of French Revolution, course of French Revolution, results of French Revolution. We have all studied that. That's how it was written. It's nothing wrong. That's the way history was explained then. Growth of the Empire, 1379 to 1406. Devaraya first, 1406 to 14. He was an important emperor. Although you can't call him a splendid sovereign like we called Rajaraja Rajendra. But Devaraya first and Devaraya second, they were important. Then Devaraya second, 1419, 1444 or 1449. There is a debate for 5 years. City of Vijayanagara in the reign of Devaraya second. Close of the first dynasty, 1449 to 1490. That is, the first dynasty was Sangama, followed by Saluva, followed by Tuluva, and finally by Aravidu. It is four different dynasties. Reign of Krishnadevaraya, 1509 to 1530, on which the Professor Srinivas Reddy gave a lecture, and the biography is also there. 8th August 1509, as per his inscription. So that's why 8th August is important. And chapter 11, Siege and Battle of Raichur and Close of Krishnadevaraya's Reign, 1520 to 1530. Chapter 12, Buildings, Works and Inscriptions of Krishnadevaraya. Chapter 13, The Reign of Achyutaraya. Chapter 14, The Beginning of the End, the Sadasivaraya's Reign. Chapter 15, Destruction of Vijayanagara, 1565, Ramaraya. Chapter 16, Third Dynasty. It is here that Hyderabad comes into existence. And chapter 17, the story of Bharadas. Then to this, the narrative Domingo Pais is attached. So this is the story of the first grand narrative of the first dynasty. Then when you actually see the landmarks of interest, from that point of view, the study of Vijayanagar generated a lot of interest. Caesar Federici, as I told you, he was the first Italian traveler who visited these ruins. After the Battle of Talcahuano, he visited the ruins in 1567. Then in 1800, Colin Mackenzie collected some maps. In 1856, Alexander Greenlaw took photographs. And, you know, these photographs were recovered from paper wax negatives. And the Archaeological Survey of India was formed in 1902-1914. Then Sewell's publication we discussed. The next important publication was A.H. Longhurst, 1917. It is the first guidebook for the ruins. The title itself is Hampi Ruins Described and Illustrated. Then in 1936, Vijayanagara Sexcentenary Commemoration Volume. It has a lot of information. It was edited by D.P. Kamarkar and S. Krishnasamy Iyengar. And then after that, you have people working on it. At least three people I would like to mention, including my guide, B.A. Salator, Venkat Ramanaya, and Dr. T.V. Mahalingam. He wrote the first book on Vijayanagar from the Tamil Nadu side in 1940. So now, I would not like to go into the historiography at this stage. I would like to take the historiography slightly differently as approaches a little later, because when we teach, or when I teach, or when I taught, I always introduced Vijayanagara history with four or five approaches. Orientalist approach, represented by Robert Sewell. The nationalist approach, I can give a list. All these people, including my guru, they were writing from the nationalist point of view. Then nationalism also had its regional sentiments. So regionalist writings were also there. Then the segmentary state model of Steen, which we have discussed. Then the national project 1975 was the game changer. I will discuss that a little later. And then the material, cultural, architectural approach. This is what has not come into the classroom. Even at the MA level, unfortunately, we try to bring in. So now, if this is the state of affairs, now how textbooks will deal with it and the kind of books that we use, we prescribe. I will discuss four books which are popular. At least one is very popular. That is of Professor Satish Chandra. Any IAS aspirant uses the two-volume medieval history, Sultanate, as well as the second Mughal one. So medieval India, from Sultanate to the Mughals, 1506 to 1526, volume one. What is the problem? The problem that is visualized by Satish Saab is also the problem of framing a syllabus. The framing a syllabus and writing a book, you know, almost the exercise is the same. You see, his purpose is to have a two-volume work, one on Sultanate and another on Mughals. Where will Vijayanagar come? It will come under definitely volume one, under this, I mean, the Sultanate period, the period that is delimited. And then where does he end? He ends in 1526. Where does Vijayanagar end? 1565. So chapter 10, it's extended. Chapter 10 is extended. This is how one has to understand. And what is the title? Politics, State, Society, and Economy in South India under Vijayanagar and Bahmini rule. You see, this is another strategy. Bahmini and Vijayanagar is combined. 11 battles for Raichur Doab is listed. So as if nothing else happened in Vijayanagar except that they were fighting with each other for control of Raichur Doab. So this is the kind of thing which will go to the student. So student is definitely sure. It is relevant. Whether they were fighting over Raichur, it is definitely yes. But that is not the only thing. There are several other things. So for that one, he will get 10 marks instead of 25. We have to give. Because some relevance is there. So its nature and conflict with Bahmini Kingdom. Bahmini Kingdom, its growth and disintegration. And once you study Bahmini, then only Mohammad Gawan becomes important. So that is why I will come back to Eton little later when I talk about biographies. So Mohammad Gawan is the life. through which Bahmini could be explained. The return of the biography, and through biography as a lens, you can comprehend the social process. I'll come back to that a little later. So the climax of Vijayanagar and its disintegration. I'm not critical, whether it is an NCRT book or an expanded book, the information that is available is given only in this form, in a descriptive manner, because there is no analysis. Now comes the gentleman whom we talked about in great detail. And I also mentioned about Buttonstein's book. Very few people wrote textbooks. Buttonstein also wrote a textbook. We discussed that. Communities as states and all that. And Buttonstein, A History of India, 1998. It was a posthumous publication I mentioned. It was completed by his wife, Sanjay Subramaniam, and David Washbrook. Chapter 3 in that book is Medieval India, Deccan and South, Vijayanagara, in pages 152 to 159. Look at the title. States and Communities. It is not communities without states. It is not communities as states, but it is the next stage, his original scheme, which I mentioned. If you refer that, you will see here, states and communities. Role of firearms in state formation. Look at the quality change. Role of firearms in state formation, economic development, brief moment of centralized authority. He also concedes there were centralized efforts, but the state could not completely become centralized. It was only a centralized effort. So that is the kind of stand, if you see the analysis also I mentioned. So then see also chapter 8. You have to see both together. Chapter 8, because his writing of Vijayanagar in New Cambridge Economic History is totally different from this format. I'll come back to that for a detailed analysis. This is what these nuances, I think teachers have to get it somehow, these changes. So see also chapter 8, where Vijayanagar rule in 1980, present state and society, page 366 to 488. Substantial discussion of Vijayanagara state in chapter 8. Threefold purpose. He makes it very, very clear. In writing this chapter, he makes a threefold purpose. To examine the political system of macro region of Vijayanagara. You see, he made a distinction between micro region. For him, always it was Nadu. So macro region, Vijayanagara state. He wants to prove that also as segmented state. That is purpose number one. Purpose number two, new elements of South Indian society. Does he recognize new elements or not? He does recognize. What are the new elements? Muslims have come in, Telugus have come in, Europeans have come in, all that he discusses. Then now, the third purpose is to provide a cogent background for the changes of 19th century. He comes back, his original idea, whether India had the potential or the state structures which can take it to modernity. See, this is what I also discussed when I talked about Buttonstein. So this is the way to understand his chapter 3 in that textbook. Then comes the next important publication, Catherine Asher and Cynthia Talbot. The title, that also I would definitely bring it under a textbook only. India Before Europe. This was published in 2006. Chapter 3, Southern India in the Age of Vijayanagar, 1350 to 1550. Vijayanagara militarism. You see, look at, and always one has to remember that when you compare the pre-1300 and post-1300 period, we have to recognize increased militarization of state and society. Whichever state that existed in India, whether it is Sultanate, whether it is Mughals, whether it is Vijayanagar. So otherwise, your Ikta has no meaning. Otherwise, Nayaka has no meaning. Nayankara has no meaning. So increase the militarization of state and society. Then monetization, because already the trade in Southeast Asia has come in. So monetization. So once monetization, increased monetization, commodity production in monetized framework will be different from the earlier one. So all these things come into focus. So militarism, Vijayanagara militarism, and what they did was to give a kind of cultural orientation to the study of Vijayanagara. Islamicate influence, and they were the first, in my opinion, to draw our attention to creation of a pan-South Indian culture. It is not that it is different from Indian culture, but the opportunity that Vijayanagara gave for consolidating the elements of what we generally called Telugu or Deccan or Kannada or Kerala. So the pan-South Indian culture definitely evolved. Trade, commerce, domestic economy are all discussed. When we come to the last 2019 publication of Professor Richard Eaton in the India in the Persian 80 Age, the time period discussed is 1000 to 1765. Here it is chapter 4. Deccan and South between 1400 and 1650. See the period he has brought it to 1400. Political and cultural evolution at Vijayanagara. The very title of the chapter is very important. That shifting, that's why I put that question. Why are you using political culture? I mean, what do you have anything special to say? So only for clarification, I understood, but I thought that in a discussion, others will also get it. See, it is this shift which I have been talking about. So far, we were talking more about political economy. Now we are talking about political culture. There is no mention of economy at all. Not that there was no economy, but the focus is on political culture, which has a lot of theoretical underpinnings. Sangamas declared official. Then he gives a very interesting explanation of this. Sangamas declared their official deity as Virupaksha, because I told you the original name of Vijayanagara was Veera Vijaya Virupaksha Pura. 15th century onwards, you find the increasing patronage to Vishnu. This is very, very important. Suppose you take Professor Srinivas Reddy's book, Andhra Vishnu appearing in the dream of Krishnadevaraya. I hope people have read the biography. I've read it fully. I'm confident that Andhra Vishnu, he is called Andhra Mahavishnu, but he is located where? Near Chittur, Tirupati. So Eaton gives a very interesting explanation to that. And you know, Krishnadevaraya during his renal period visited Tirupati 7 times. He himself personally visited 7 times, not only the dream visit. Is also very important. And Vishnu particularly is in his avatar. Devaraya first built the Rama temple. Efficient use of mythic landscape. Then the Hampi area is considered to be the Kishkindha area. So I will come back to all that building up a little later. But just remember, these are all the inputs that we have to remember. Eaton uses a very interesting explanation. He calls it hybrid theology. He used an expression called hybrid theology. Ideal devotees of Shiva. Ideal king as Rama. Devotee of Shiva. Ideal king as Rama. And then Balakrishna to satisfy the coastal areas. Every village formed in Tanjore or Tirunelveli during this period, you will have a Navaneeta Krishna or somebody facing down the Agrahara. The Shiva temple will be in the northeast corner of the village. So then to Balakrishna. So Virupaksha for core, Venkateswara for Tamil and southern Andhra, conquered territory, Balakrishna for coastal, and for appealing to the Deccan and Maratha area, Pandharpur. Panduranga Vittala for Northern Deccan. So he makes a claim for fusion of theology with sovereign territory. So this is the explanation given by Eaton. Please go and read that chapter, Political and Cultural Evolution. So it is not that the economy has been neglected. T.V. Mahalingam, K. Nilakant Shastri, Sanjay Subramaniam, Stephen Jayasila, all have written. But at this stage, I don't want to go into details. So because we can keep it for a discussion. No, these are the ways in which textbooks have to be understood. Then there is another category of book which reflects the research of the author predominantly, but at the same time, because they are dealing with a larger territory, they accommodate the other authors' ideas also. So in this category, I will put two people. The original textbook is that History of South India by Neelkanth Shastri. I would like to consider that as a tool book. And then Nobur Karshima's Concise History of South India, Karshima edited OUP 2014 as a tool book. So to just give an example, because of the paucity of time we are having. So if you see Neelkanth Shastri's book, 1955 or the 2009 revised edition, chapter 12 is The Empire of Vijayanagara. It starts in page 264 for your and chapter 13, Social and Economic Conditions, Literature, Religion, Art and Architecture. You see, that is the pattern which he followed. That is what I called the synchronic, this thing of polity, etc. So Empire, first, 12 chapter, 13, Social and Economic Conditions, 14, Literature, Sanskrit, Tamil, Kannada, Telugu, Malayalam. He makes very specific discussions on all the languages. Then he calls it Religion and Philosophy in chapter 15, and chapter 16 is Art and Architecture. We have seen and we have described this book as conventional, politico-military, descriptive study, great man-centric, etc., synthesis of prior scholarship, using available archive, severely scientific, and genuinely artistic. You might recall my two statements that we actually made. So now this is an old book. It's not that it is unimportant. People can start with it. They can read. But with this concern, they should read. And this discretion, they should use the book. The information used as used by Neelkanth Shastri. That's how I would like to put it. Now, 1955 to 2014, nearly 60 years. So a lot of things have happened in the study of Vijayanagara. It has grown. There is knowledge explosion. To a certain extent, almost all done by Karashima and the team have come in this, with few others giving in a little input. So this book is important. Anyone who is reading at the postgraduate level, they should not only use the latest book of Catherine Asher and Eaton, Persian at Age, but next level of study is this book. Concise History of South India, Karshima edited, OUP publication, 2014. Chapter 6 is on Vijayanagara. See, it doesn't say Vijayanagara. His pattern here is, he has not used early medieval, medieval like that. He has avoided the labels. He has gone by developments as he studied, because the source that he used was inscription. So that's why it is better for him to go to changes identified in the centuries, and he has followed that kind of a century caption. 15th century to 17th century, Vijayanagara state and wider world. I want everyone to start with this book. After reading either Eaton or Catherine Asher, they should come to this book. This will be an ideal start for a teacher and also for a serious MA student. Vijayanagara and the Sultanates in the Deccan. Vijayanagara states and Nayaks. Nayak system. Early polity. Development of trade and industry. Hindu Sultan and religions. There are two sections. Architecture and sculpture. Nayaka states and the emergence of new ethos. The coming of the Europeans. Advent of Portuguese. Competition between the Dutch and the English. Decline of the Dutch and the advent of the French. You see, he has realized the importance of putting the two periods together. What two periods? Vijayanagar and their successors. It makes a lot of sense as far as South India or particularly Tamil Nadu is concerned. So the time period will be 1350 to 1650. And after 1650, you have the Marathas. It goes up to, say, 1750 or so. So that's another way of putting it. But he has put the Nayaks and the Vijayanagara together. That is why he has made it plain 15th to 17th century. But actual time period will be 1350 to, say, about 1650. So each one should read this, because some of this I'll be going into detail a little later. So this is a way to start with, a good textbook and a tool book. Then comes the detailed research. I will try to give you some major trends. As I told you, there are 4 or 5 approaches which we have to recognize: Orientalist, Nationalist, Regionalist, Segmentary State, National Project, Material Cultural. So now the game changer here, like there, the game changer was Subrayalu's Political Geography. I mentioned that the basic one is the benchmark study and the game changer. Here the game changer is the Nationalist Project of Professor Nurul Hasan. Hampi, Fatehpur Sikri, Champaner. 3 places were recognized for intensive study, intensive with a medieval archaeological kind of mind. So extensive archaeological excavations and conservation they wanted to do. So 75 is the national project, of which Champaner was a non-starter. It was given to Professor S.C. Mishra. Unfortunately, he died, and after that, it did not start. Fatehpur Sikri progressed, and then with that Anup Talaw incident, it was abandoned. So now Hampi went on and produced how many? I mean, you'll see. It is the time. I mean, it is that time I joined Delhi University. I was interested. I was getting the reports as and when they were published, and I was also in touch with some of them. I was really thrilled at the way that, I would like to quote a sentence of Professor Bertenstein, which everybody has missed and which is really important. So this national project here, Karnataka Directorate of Archaeology and Museums, we call it KDAM. It happened in the 80s. In the early 80s, the site came under a team of international scholars. But again, people make a common mistake. You know, where was this located? Why Bertenstein got interested? If somebody asked me the question, I will say, it was in the Cedar district. Colonel Monroe was the first person to be appointed as collector of the Cedar district. So that 1800, also the Mackenzie, Monroe, these people took a lot of interest in collecting antiquities and all these things. So that aspect is also there. I'm not going into that. But 80s, I'm only concentrating. A team of international scholars also joined. That is very, very important. There was a seminar in 1983 at Heidelberg, University of South Asia Institute. The deliberations first came in 2 volumes, Vijayanagara City and Empire. And after this, Bertenstein also probably participated and got that. He wrote a paper in that. The paper is titled Reapproaching Vijayanagara. Subtitle is Puzzles of Hampi. See, it is here I give a lot of importance to Professor Bertenstein and his ability to question. And I wanted to give the observation after raising the puzzles, but since I have mentioned, I would just like to quote Bertenstein, these puzzles that I have raised, I will come back to the puzzles a little later. I mean, after reading his statement, these puzzles demanded an interdisciplinary collaboration. Several fields of knowledge with different concepts and methods like archaeology, epigraphy, architecture, art, sociology, literature, and history had to collaborate. New knowledge can be produced only from the friction among different kind of knowers. I would like to repeat this. New knowledge can be produced only from the friction among different kind of knowers. It is indeed a template for interdisciplinary scholarship to know India's past. I'm quoting Button from Reapproaching Vijayanagara. So now, what are the questions that he raised? The questions he raised, or the puzzles which he posed as puzzles, are the following. It is a national project. It is on Hampi city, its construction, its relation to the empire at large, influence of Karnataka's past. What is the relevance between the past and the present? Which were the immediate past? Chalukyas. Is there any relationship between the Chalukyan past and the Vijayanagara present? Like later on people raised, is the Maratha state, Vijayanagara state, the precursor of Maratha state? If you are arguing within Hindu, that will be the kind of continuity. So here, historically, Chalukya, Vijayanagara connection, and epistemological and methodological issues. And he formulated 5-6 puzzles, which are very interesting and important. Was there a single spirit, an expressive purpose, which guided the construction of the city from the time of Vijayanagara founders of 14th century to the middle of 16th century? What is the purpose of construction of the city? That is the question. What was the relationship between Vijayanagara occupancy of the site to the pre-Vijayanagara Tirtha? Because we get a lot of cock and bull stories. we have stories like a rabbit was being chased by a hound. When it reached the particular spot, the rabbit became the hound and hound became the rabbit. So you establish a city here. The myth making and legends, all these are all available. Not only for that, it is replicated elsewhere also in our part of the territory, Pandya territory also. So what is the real purpose, occupancy, whether it has got any relation to Tirthas? Because none of the 7 important Tirthas are near Vijayanagar. Third, from observations of the city, is it possible to delineate zones or parts? How the city is to be related to the large peninsular territory which the state conquered? Does the city in some technical sense control its complex cultural hinterland? Because that was his interesting question. But was it only controlled by taxes and law, force, etc.? Or did it have a standing army? Those kinds of things he was having in mind. To call it a segmentary state or to modify his statements. Does the city simply represent or symbolically incorporate all the elements which were subordinated? Is it possible merely to know the city and not to know the relationship between city and society? So he raised a lot of larger questions. So that resulted in the archaeological part of it. So material, cultural phase. So for teachers, to start with, I think one of the participants who have been regularly coming, probably Dr. Nalini Thakur is a contributor to this volume. Oxford has brought out a book, South India under Vijayanagar. So this will be a very useful volume for the teacher who is teaching at the MA level of the new archaeo-architectural approach, because all aspects have been very well covered. So in fact, the very first article is by Carla Sinopoli. She has given a very good account of the Vijayanagara research that has progressed so far. Then the archaeological work is summarized by Nagaraja Rao. Archaeological atlas of the project, it's very important, by John Fritz. Vijayanagara Metropolitan Region, it is written by Kathleen Morrison. Heritage Management is written by Nalini Thakur. Conserving Cultural Heritage by Sarat Chandra. Public-private partnership in maintaining this lamb. Earliest photographs, which I mentioned, Greenlaw's photograph, that is done by Michel. And the inscriptions related to the monuments, Rajasekara. Sculptures at the great platform, that people know that there is a Mahanavami platform. So the sculptures at the great platform, Anna Dala Piccola. Chalukyan past, a stepped tank has been found at the Royal Center. This is by Philip Wagner. And Sacred Topography by Anila Vargis. All these are in section 1. That is Hampi, Vijayanagara. Section 2 is on city and empire, the kind of questions that we were discussing. Power relationship through Vijayanagara inscriptions, Alexander Mack. Development of Gopura by Anila Varghese. This is what I'm going to elaborate, the third aspect. Ramayana in Southern Indian art, Anna Della Piccola. Then Chaturmukha temple, art, architecture, Shaivite ascetic iconography, landscape, propaganda and power. Some of my friends are interested in coinage. So here, coinage is studied by Barbara Mears, propaganda and power, and Vijayanagara art by Chudamani Nandagopal. So there is a range. See, this is, that's why I call this is a game changer. The cultural, material, cultural approach. So I would like to highlight only one point. Generally, we associate archaeology with early historic, prehistoric, that way. But somebody took interest on medieval archaeology and look at the kind of questions raised. What we generally talk, what is generally discussed in inscriptions, what is the kind of archaeological remains that were actually looked for. I would like to draw your attention to a book by Kathleen Morrison, published in 1995, and the Indian edition came 5 years later. I couldn't see the earlier one. I could see only the 2000 volume published by Munshiram Manohar Lal. It considers the agricultural strategies practiced by Vijayanagara. Can anybody think of what are the kinds of agricultural practices that was there? It's talking mainly on descriptions and actually on archaeological remains. There is a qualitative difference between the two. What were the food products? Using evidence from original research on archaeology, paleography, and written text, how the land was subjected to intensification of culture, I mean agriculture, a process important for founding the city and its dramatic expansion in early 16th century. Archaeologically, they were looking for evidences. So agricultural intensification, agricultural production, if you look at the chapters and the study, it is really a very important and very fresh kind of a study for Indian agricultural production and studies. We talk about models, model of population growth and agricultural intensification set by Danish economist Bostrup, Esther Bostrup. Population as an independent variable is not acceptable because the Chicago school, when we develop it for study of cities, we call that model as POET, P-O-E-T, population, organization, environment, and technology. So causes of intensification, land use, history of the region, in and around the city, archaeological remains, analysis of pollen, spores, charcoal, sediments. Then they go on to make agricultural product study, agricultural production, climate, soil, topography, wet, dry, and wet come dry. So it is this which actually influenced Bertenstein, ecotypic variations. There was also another colleague of his, a friend, Brian Martin and all. So that's why when I gave a reply to somebody who asked me whether annals influence, no, it is more of this kind of influence, I think. Agriculture is put in the context through previous archaeological research, metropolitan survey, agricultural land use, historical records there, identifying land use through pollen and charcoal, and then they have a conclusion. The sequence, domestic changes in 16th century only, and then after Battle of Talaikota, all these things are not available. Many new monumental structures, Basavanna Canal, Raya Kere, and all this information and this thing in the intensification dies after 1565. Okay. We can't apply de-urbanization here. It's an effort to build a city and then that's all. Intensification, proper specialization, diversification products. It's a very important study as far as medieval archaeology is concerned. So everyone who is interested in medieval archaeology should read this book by Kathleen Morrison. Then including myself, as students of Dr. Mahalingam, we wanted to react to the ongoing things, and my friend, one publisher, and then Professor Shanmugam of Madras University, he took the lead. Sir, let us bring out a volume in memory of our guru, Dr. T.V. Mahalingam. So we brought out a volume in 2006, Recent Advances in Vijayanagara Studies. So since 80s, all these things have been happening. So history of Vijayanagara was studied with more renewed interest. So new discoveries, it is in this that I picked up the study of music, because my interest was shifting. So in this volume, I want to briefly give you some of these contributors have contributed here also, and they have given in a very simple language the extensive research that has gone on. So you have traditional studies also, you have research on inscriptions also, you also have writings on the new approach also in this. It's a good collection. Distance Administration under Vijayanagara by K.G. Krishna, the guru of Nobu Karashima. Administrative Divisions in Vijayanagara State by Professor Y. Subrayalu. Nayak Kattanam and Sirmai. Of course, this is discussed in the 2014 volume also by Karashima. Same. Nayangara System in Andhra. Vijayanagara City and Inscriptional Study. Land Use and Settlement. It is this, what I was talking about, medieval archaeology, it has been explained here very well by Sinopoli and Morrison. Land Use and Settlement in the Vijayanagara Metropolitan Region. Results of the Vijayanagara Metropolitan Survey. They have given the results of that survey. Noblesman's Palaces in Hampi. Centers of Production and Market System in Tamil Country by Shanmugam. Early Modern Trade and Great Field of Commodities by a foreign author, Janis, and then maintenance and repair of irrigation works. This is what I'll come back to that later. If at all, one important thing that I take from Vijayanagara's historical experience, as an historical experience, investment in small scale irrigation. To me, it appears to be a very important investment. Maintenance and repair of irrigation works, because people concentrated, Nayaks, they were employed in maintaining all this. If you go to Bajra, Tanjore, or those areas, maintenance work. Of course, I took history of music in Vijayanagara and Nayak phase. I started writing on music here only. Depiction of foreigners in Vijayanagara, Anila Varghese, Veerabhadra temple, two Harihara images, bronze image, portrayal of Vijayanagara in Rafiuddin. This is a very important idea. Rafiuddin Shirazi. This many people would not have noticed. This is a very important Persian document. Portrayal of Vijayanagara in a Persian document. So, the renewed interest that I have been talking about. So, it can be seen in these two volumes which I mentioned. Now, the third part. I'm very conscious about the time, because I definitely exceed 60 minutes. But still, I would like to cover a field, because I am filing it more as a trend report, and I have not gone into the theme, any of the theme deeply, but I am only giving, you know, this is the way so much of this has been done, and how to bring it into a classroom is very difficult, although we tried. I tried to bring some of them into my classroom, but this has to be filed and people should know this much has happened on city of Vijayanagara. So now I'll come back to some individuals who have some modern and really good ideas. So I'll come back to Bartenstein. Come away from peasant state and society of 1980, come to 1989, he has a full book on Vijayanagara amidst all these things that we have talked about. So now that is why maybe I unconsciously or consciously I gave the title Historian at Work. So here I will demonstrate. Look at the chapterization of this book. This is New Cambridge History of India, 1989. See the concern of the general editor. Many of the histories are uneven in quality. Somebody writing in 1989. Many of the histories are uneven in quality. This is written by that R.I. Moore. I told you that he is writing about Bartenstein. In that volume, it's an introduction. some have come out of date very rapidly, but their virtue has been that they have consistently done more than simply record an existing state of knowledge. They have tended to focus interest on research, and they have provided a massive stimulus to further work. So, what are the things which we have to take from the work done so far? Rayas were peninsular overlords, no problem. Their capital was the symbol of vast power and wealth. It has come in as city and empire. Lordships of all sorts became more powerful than ever before. This resulted from martialization of its politics. So that martialization, militarization of state and society, it is happening. Everybody is acknowledging. And the transfiguring of older economic and social institutions of forces of urbanization and commercialization and monetization. Same Buttonstein, who underplayed all this in Vijayanagar, no urbanization, he recognizes that here. These changes were gradual and only dimly perceived during the time of its first dynasty, who were content with Digvijaya, righteous conquest of Tamil country only, reduced Cholas and Pandya and made them pay homage to us. Then the second idea he talks about, the Vijayanagara era was one in which I see a new form of polity. He also talks about new form of polity, but doesn't call it new formation as Noboru Karashima calls, but one with important links to earlier polities. So he has a full chapter in this book, Medieval Past, Continuity or Disjunction. Continuity or Disjunction. This is the 1989 book. But maintains it was segmentary in character, where kings were essentially ritual figures. There is no change in his position. Three, massive architectural style that permeated all of the southern peninsula in the building and rebuilding of temples, permanent non-religious or civil buildings, including royal palaces, to the expansion of agrarian institutions as well as its new forms and its commerce over the entire peninsula, and to the proliferation of whole structures of local rights or entitlements by all sorts of social groups who constitute society, over which the first of the colonial institutions came to be imposed in the late 18th century. He's talking about permanent settlement. So now look at the chapterization. Very interesting. He also has historiography. First, what is kind of history written on Vijayanagara and all. You can find whatever I gave here also. The second is important. Medieval past, continuity or disjunction. Was Vijayanagara a precursor of Maratha state? He himself raises that question. He says that four distinct lineages have ruled. And he also highlights impact of war on society. This came in 89. I gave this topic to one of my MPhil students who did an excellent work, Dr. Nilanjan Sarkar, who is now Deputy Director of Research in London School of Economics. Impact of Battle of Talaikota on South Indian society. That is the MPhil thesis that was done in the State Department. Look at the third chapter, Politics and Ecology. So the, I won't give, he is looking at it as politics and ecology and not a holistic annual kind of a treatment of Philip II or those kinds of questions which may be there, but politics and ecology. Politics and military, city and kingdom. So he is reflecting the ongoing research and reformulated. Political geography, and then demography and moving of the agricultural frontier, old and new political order, political economy and society, territorial segmentation, imperial collapse and aftermath, transition from medieval past to modern future. He has a section on that. So Krishnadevaraya replaced earlier royal predecessors, improved war capability, dual sovereignty continued. These are the ways in which he has formulated this book, New Cambridge, History, Vijayanagara. So this is totally different from that chapter on peasant state and society, except that the continuity of the principle of segmentary state. some rethinking, some modification, some nuancing has been done. So now the second person who have worked extensively on this is Noboru Karashima. Nowadays, you see an omnibus book, I think. Earlier, it came separately. 1992, the title of the book was New Formation. Two books are important. Concordance of Naiks. It is not as voluminous as the Concordance of Chola Inscriptions. This is a single volume. And the New Formation, these two books reflect his ideas. So I will summarize. I don't want to, because I will just take about 5-10 minutes because I have to talk about a few other things as well. He wants to contribute to the scholarly dialogue regarding continuity and change in pre-modern India. Same concern, no difference. Second, social structure in rural society, class relations, and nature of state. His concerns are three. He is interested in the social structure in rural society, class relations, and nature of state. And he adds a caution that's very, very important. And generally, people have missed and they have started applying to Andhra also because the Nayankara system prevailed in Andhra. Some people are throwing this caution to the winds. Warned against generalizing too widely from limited evidence. I am doing it thoroughly. Quantitative techniques. So my findings do not blindly apply to other areas without studying them. He gives this caution in more than 4 or 5 places. Sought to revise the theory of stagnation of Indian society. The Indian society was dynamic. It was not stagnant. There he is very, very clear. The larger issue of defining societal change in a manner consistent with the detailed analysis of inscriptions. Naturally, he rejected Kathleen Gow's AMP as a stage from where feudalism developed. I think I mentioned earlier also or somewhere, I don't know. He did not take a position, theoretical position, when he studied Cholas. But when he is convinced on one of his colleague, Nakamura's study of Japan, where feudalism is applicable, but feudalism has to come from something earlier. So that then he concedes AMP as a stage from which, if this is in feudalism, that is state slavery. He writes only in this book in the introduction. Otherwise, he has not taken a theoretical position. I would like to understand feudalism. He gives a definition I will quote. It is better I quote him. I would like to understand feudalism theoretically as having the four features. Basic direct producers are not slaves but peasants who own their means of production. He is convinced on that. Local magnates possess superior rights, subdue peasants, and extract surplus produce by means of extra economic coercion. 3. Political power assumes a hierarchical structure which is sustained by land grants among ruling class and also a certain ideology. 4. Commodity production is not generalized but limited only to the surplus portion which is appropriated by the ruling class. 1992, page 39, note 6. So I've just quoted. So 16th century Nayaka rule and Natavar activities was feudalistic only for Tamil Nadu. He has not put it in italics or anything, but he is making that caution. Though it is uncertain whether we can generalize for whole of Vijayanagara state, within brackets, he has himself put a question mark. State slavery for Chola state feudalism for Vijayanagara, theoretical position has come in for the first time. And he goes on to quote Marx. This is also people should note. We may quote from Marx. He also explains state slavery as the mode of production of a society where the peasants submerged in the community were the slaves of the community. Namely, peasants were not slaves in the sense they were owned by others, but in their dependence on the community as a whole. So it is in that sense he says that. So once again, I draw the attention of my colleagues who are teaching this paper and also serious MA students. Read that concise history of South India. Chapter 6-1, Nayaka system, 6-4, Hindu Sultan and religions, and 6-6, 6.6, Nayaka States and Emergence of a New Ethos. This is very, very important. So the chapters in New Foundation and all these things, you can see. But that is the next level of what is original research and then what are the conclusions. So that is for an MPhil or a PhD student. I think MA students should stop with this toolbook projection. Of course, they should see concordance. MA students should see that. Then trend number, these two we already know. Now I will come to a certain part where these trends are not generally followed, but to my mind, they are very important trends to be noted. Two works, Philip Wagner, Tidings of the King, Ethno-Historical Analysis of Raya Vachakamu in 1993, and Textures of Time by Welcher, Narayan Rao, Shulman, Sanjay Subramaniam in 2001. To my mind, they are also very, very significant. It is here, Sanjay Subramaniam, I said, if you would recall, whispers or shouts. So you have been talking about inscriptions whispering in your ears. Now we have talking about literary productions, which are shouts. It's a very jokingly put. Historiography had established a significant place for itself in southern ecology of genres by the 16th and 17th centuries. It is like Romila Thapar talking about the past before us, or what is history as far as indigenous perception of history is concerned. You should take that in that sense. A group of new literati crystallized within an associated institutional framework. They are called Karanam. So you have three Karanam here, Munshi or Kulkarni. They are the ones who are present in the court in North and West, in Telugu, Tamil and Marathi in the period. These texts reflect a culture of writing in prose intended for communication rather than mere recording. They are not simply there to record, but they intend to communicate. So the Raya Vachakamu studied by him, it moves freely between three kingdoms. And very interestingly, Narapati, Vijayanagar, Gajapati, Orissa, Aswapati, Sultan. So the text moves very, very freely between the three. What is important here is use of the past. So the Nayaks could justify themselves only by using Vijayanagara past because they are connected. So that's why he uses a very interesting expression called talisman of the empire. You know, people might have talked about it. Use of the past, city of victory as talisman of authority. Founding of Vijayanagara, coronation and education of Krishnadevaraya, all these things. So mistakenly, earlier writers who are writing on Vijayanagara, because there is information on Vijayanagara, they took it as a contemporary source. But Philip Wagner corrected it. No, it was not a contemporary source. It was written in 17th century in a Nayak court. So the points, to be, I don't want to go into detail. Of course, the fragments of all these appeared in S.K. Iyengar's sources in 1919 itself. But now the entire text has been studied very well by Philip Wagner. Text was produced by an author who was resident at Madurai around the 17th century. The poet submitted to Visappa, use of the past, one foot in Vijayanagara past, the other foot in Nayaka present. So that is what they call it, use of the past to legitimize the present. We make this statement, using the past to legitimize the present. Well, that's a kind of a thing which we have to recognize. It is worked in this. So then one should also read the Textures of Time, which explains. I think I earlier mentioned on Andhra Rajula Charitra, that Andhra Rajula Charitra also is to be brought to the Karanam historiography. They are talking about a literary class, which I was telling this one. So the next work, which I would like to draw your attention, is again by the same team, Symbols of Substance. It is dedicated to the memory of A.K. Ramanujan. This also came out in 1992. Vijayanagara to Nayak, Cultural Economy of Nayaka Rule, Nayaka Anthropology, Rhetoric of Kingship, Art of War under Nayaks, State Formation and Deformation, because Nayankara system produced another subsidiary system called Polygari system. Of course, I worked on that. That's why I was telling that I had to go to the archives, and I had the fortune of meeting Bert. Visions of the Fall. So towards the Marathas. So this is what is discussed in that book. Then, if you go into the field of art, this is the next trend I want to draw your attention to. There was a great art historian who contributed a lot to Indian art, Barbara Stoller Miller. People could be familiar with the name. So Vidya Dahejia, another art historian, brought out a work called Artistic Visions as a kind of dedication, because Barbara Miller died in 1993, I think. So this volume came in 1994, entirely on Ram, because people, I mentioned earlier, the Rama cult comes to the center in the Vijayanagara period, which I'm going to talk later about political culture. Just briefly, how, to me, as a historical experience, things are important. So this collection is very important. I don't know how many people would have seen this collection. It is in the field of art. The first article is by Vidya Dahejia, Rama, Hero and Avatar. I think I want everybody to read this to get the insights. Universe of Rama, Valmiki of Epic Poem, Barbara Stoller Miller. Her paper is also included. Royal legitimation. You see, the kind of ideas that is coming on political culture. That is what I draw the attention to. Ramayana portraits in Nageswara Swami Temple, Kumbakonam. I'm not mentioning the names of authors who have written. I'm only going by the top, because in another 10-15 minutes, I would like to wind up. The city of Vijayanagara. Kishkindha, the monkey kingdom. So the landscape. It is written by Anna Dalla Piccola, I would like to mention. Akbar's Imperial Ramayana, a Mughal Persian manuscript written by Ashok Kumar Das. A sub-imperial Mughal manuscript, Ramayana of Rahim Kanikana. I think only yesterday or so there was a talk. This is sub-imperial Mughal Empire. This is by John Seller. Sahibdin's Book of Battles, Jagat Singh's Yudhakand, Losty. Jatayu, the Valiant Vulture, Vernacular Art from Eastern India. The Battle of Lanka at Angkor Wat, a Visual Metaphor by Eleanor Manika. The Ram Legend as Theatre, Ram Leela at Benares. You see, look at this collection. As long, and I'm tempted to quote this, because it is a very prophetic statement by Valmiki. As long as the mountains and rivers shall endure upon the earth, so long will the story of Ramayana be told among men. This is the statement of Valmiki. Whoever reads this history of Ram, which is purifying, destructive of sin, holy and the equal of the Vedas, is freed from all sins. But it has come true. It has survived, and it comes into the fore in the political culture of Vijayanagara. So that is what I wanted to draw your attention to. So another thing generally people don't use is, I am reminded of a statement of Plato. Tradition is our friend. Science is our helper. And reality our master, said Plato. I want to repeat. Tradition is our friend. Science our helper. And reality our master, said Plato. Two trends. I want to give you an example with these two books. One, we increasingly talk about religious imagination. And then we also talk about political imagination. I want to give you two examples of this. First, religious imagination. This is written by, the title of the book is Vijayanagara Visions. Religious experience and cultural creativity. Because music particularly is combined with the saint composers that we are talking about in South India, whether it is Bhadrachala Ramadas or Puradhara Das, whatever it is. So this book is on that by William J. Jackson. I don't want to go into details of who is who and what is what. I just want to give you the range which he has written. He has written on Vidyaranya, Purandaradas, Jayatirtha, Vedanta Desika, Potanna, Vemana, Kanakadasa, Annamacharya, Appaya Dikshada, Badrajala Ramadas. You will find all of them are connected with music. It is this which attracted me to this. And then I went through the book Songs of Vishnus in the name Purandaradasa's repertoire, Nadi Yog, Vedanta Desika is considered bell of God. There is a Sahitya Academy has brought out a biography of the Vedanta Desika, drinking straight from Jayatirtha's life, Potanna, poet inspired by the chaotic order, and Annamacharya, you must have heard about his name, and tasting tunes of Purandaradasa's the Appaya Dikshada and all that. So this is another area of particularly Nadi Yog, sound, constructions, songs, etc. William Jackson. Then the last, I think, I would like to talk about, earlier also in Solas also I said, philology and textual studies. There is a lot of advancement in this. Philology, making sense of texts. Venkatanatha, Vedanta Desika, I mentioned. He has written, he's a prolific writer. After Ramanuja, he is a very important figure in Vaishnavism. So that way, again, I don't want to go into details about all this. Ritual context gave way to political concerns. This kind of exercises, ritual context gave way to political this thing. So especially Sanjay Subramaniam also has a penumbral visions, the making of polities in early modern South India. It has been explained in a slightly different way. So now, continuing on Rama cult at Vijayanagara, you must have heard about Sheldon Pollack. I mentioned last time also. Immediately after Babri Masjid, he wrote an article in JAS, Journal of Asiatic Studies, Ramayana and Political Imagination in India, 1993. The first occasion for him to intervene in the debates, Rama's story, Muslim mother, and all that. So the legitimate question is how and why the Rama cult is elevated. So there is a lot of discussion on Appaya Dikshada, this and all that. So in any case, elevation of Ramayana cult happened during Vijayanagara period, people cannot deny. It did happen. So that medieval past is continuing in a certain sense. For the values, cultural values. Then the last area is biographies. Richard Eaton wrote that social history of Deccan 1300 to 1761. Now Srinivas Reddy's that also people are talking about. But Richard Eaton wrote, and he has a very interesting observation to make. The observation is, Deccan does not have a proper, Ferishta himself mapped the region differently on vernacular languages. If people have read it carefully, four sons of India, who had three sons, Marhat, Marathas, Kannar, Kannada, Tiling, Telugu. So he himself wrote like that. So there is no narrative holding Deccan together. I think one friend questioned earlier. But I don't want to go into details of that. And Eaton's return of biography, he chose eight lives. Not Krishnadevaraya, he chose Ramaraya actually. If you see that volume, you will have social banditry also. Papudu, Gawan, many other this thing you will find. So I would like to wind up this discussion after showing that these are the ways in which Vijayanagara has been studied. I had an occasion to give a valedictory address on the 500th year of coronation of Vijayanagara in 2009 at Madras for Contemporary Society. If you ask me, I would like to tell my students, each one of these is to be taken as a historical experience of India. The chief features which are surviving has to be highlighted. So if you put me that question, what is the relevance of Vijayanagara today, or what is the experience? I will say political culture is real. I mean, those elements are continuing. Investment in small-scale irrigation, yes. Storage economy, yes. Society was on the move, particularly on pilgrimage. And otherwise, you will not have chatram and chavadis and all that. Sectarian developments are real. The spirit of tolerance, if people could tolerate the sectarian differences, they tolerated everything. There is no need for asking this question, what was the policy, etc. There was spirit of tolerance. Growth of vernacular literature, yes. That also has to be acknowledged. Cultural creativity, that's why I wrote Vijayanagara Nayak face. Music was cultural creativity, but was at height. Then the bad thing that happened is identity politics. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir, for taking out time from your schedule to do this amazing and very interesting lecture, because it is always so nice to listen to you on various empires, including the one you did on Chola and other historical studies. So if anybody would like to ask any question, you can. And I think we have a question from Dr. V. Balambal. Ma'am, you can unmute yourself. I'll just send you the request. You can unmute yourself, ma'am.
Yes, I mean, good evening to all. Hello, Mani. Very good evening.
Good evening, Bala.
Yeah, very, very interesting lecture as usual. Mani's character, that. So nice. But I have doubts only. I won't say it's a question to question you, but to clear my doubt, I want you to answer the three important ones I have chosen. One is, I'll tell all the three, then you can answer. One is, you were telling about the Vijayanagar is feudalistic only in Tamil Nadu. You said, no, it is feudalistic in character only in Tamil Nadu. Why not in other places? Why in Tamil Nadu alone? That's one. Two, you were telling about the Rama culture, which was very, very popular during the Vijayanagara period. But actually, even this Tirupati Venkateswara temple and other things are more popular, I should say. But how is it you are telling that Rama cult was more important and more popular? I won't say important, more popular there in this region. And the third one, you were telling about religious imagination and then the political imagination. But why do you use why used imagination? Is it imagination when you were telling about various people's name, the singers or the devotees and so on? I don't think they were imagining things and doing. It is what they felt real only they have done. So these three questions I'll be happy if you could answer.
Yeah, I have understood the three questions. I'll reply.
Thank you.
I am not saying feudalistic. See, in this presentation, I did not give any of my personal opinion. The feudalism, this thing was conveyed to you as Karashima's position. You know, first, I want to make a very clear this thing here. Karashima, I think you were the one who asked me on Bertenstein, whether I agree with Bertenstein or with Karashima. I think that I didn't answer straight away there, because Karashima did not explicitly say his theoretical position on Cholas. Only when he brought this new formation in 1992, in the introduction, he mentions about Nakamura, another colleague who is talking about Japanese kind of development there, and Karashima for the first time takes a position. He cautions, I have studied the inscriptions thoroughly. I have subjected them to analysis, quantitative analysis. And I am now sure, I am convinced that on the basis of my study, I am saying feudalism for the Vijayanagara period. Feudalization of segments of Vijayanagara period. And if I have to say this, then we have to have something else in Chola period. That could be called state slavery. there also Marx has talked about state slavery. It is Karashima's thing. So I am not going to mechanically suggest that this should be applicable to all of Vijayanagara state unless people make a study, either accept or refute. It is that I conveyed. Second, the Rama cult, we should not mix up the Vaishnavism kind of a concept, whether Kamban also wrote on Ramavatar. I'm not denying that. But Ram cult became important here because I took up the explanation of Eaton. He talks about a hybrid theology. I think I mentioned, because four different lineages ruled. In Vijayanagar, it's not single, like in the case of Cholas. You have the Sangamas, we have the Saluvas, we have the Tuluvas, and then we have the Aravid, isn't it? So he is talking about some kind of a hybrid theology. So in that hybrid theology, you see, each one had to say, I am an ideal person to rule. So DT is Virupaksha, and Azara Ramaswamy temple comes in. So it is built to convey a certain message. That is Rama as an ideal king. That appealed more. That is why I was able to make a case for political culture. I mean, that's the lesson, or that is the value that I derive out of that exercise. I'm only talking about religious imagination and political imagination as a trend in writing history now. Muzaffar Alam has written on political Islam. So religious imagination and political imagination, I am making a distinction because William Jackson, the person first who wrote on Tyagaraja, Life and Times of you must have heard about or read about it. He brought out a book on Vijayanagara visions. So he is confining himself to the religious experience and cultural creativity. That is why I call it religious imagination as an example. This is a study. Political imagination, it has become politicized now. So that's the political culture which is continuing. The elements of political culture, that it is in that sense I presented. None of them are my views. I just made it a trend report. I think I made it very absolutely clear at the beginning itself.
So next question is from Mr. Shiva Aruni, and his question is, do you agree that too many studies and many ideological or theoretical approaches for Vijayanagar brought confusion and diverged fact-based history of Vijayanagar Empire?
It is again the question of perception. What is fact-based is something, you know, the practice of historiography has to be first understood. And you will have differences in even writing history. For example, I think Mr. Aruni from Bangalore is a good friend of mine. What is the difference between, I'll put it from Karnataka itself so that I can explain it better. Now you have two biographies. One biography was brought out in 2009. I think I have seen the book, but I don't know whether it is Surya Kant or Surya Nath. Only that I'm not able to recall. There is a book by Surya Nath Kamat, which is popular in Karnataka. I mean, it was brought out on the occasion of 500th anniversary of coronation of Vijayanagar. And then earlier, I think Dikshit Saab wrote a PhD thesis from, because since this is my identity, Vijayanagara, I was selected in Delhi University to teach medieval South India, and my identity is Vijayanagara. I'm confident, except that I may make few mistakes in the names. Otherwise, Dikshit Saab first wrote a thesis. And the way of writing inscriptions, taking it as information as a fact, and then these kinds of changes that has happened here in historiographical practices, that has probably resulted in this fact-based kind of a thing. I think ICHR Bangalore itself brought out the collection of Tamil inscriptions by Subbarayalu and Rajavelu, which I happen to edit. But the way of writing history is different. The fact-based history was there earlier. People started with that. But I think that has moved away now. philological studies are taking it away. That's why that whispers shouts this thing also I mentioned. But what is getting increasingly important is the political culture aspect. As a person, I am interested in, is it real? That political culture that was practiced then, is it being practiced now? I said, I have more than one occasion, I am saying that it is a, see, eternally, if you want to be an ideal king, who is the person who can quote in India, Indian culture? Ideal king was Ram, no doubt about it. So whether it came to the fore in Vijayanagara period, do you have evidences for that? We have to see that. Then that also becomes a fact.
Thank you very much, sir, for answering all the queries that we had. There was one query from the last lecture that you delivered on the Chola historical studies. I would because it relates to the Vijayanagara Empire.
Okay.
So this question was from Ashutosh Datta, and his question was, that how much work has been done on the Nagapattinam and the Suvarnadweep, and how much scope is there in history of trade, geopolitics and military history? That is, how trade and geopolitics regarding it had influenced the war strategies, warfare and war politics, not only just regarding the Cholas, but from Cholas to Vijayanagara Empire.
It's a good question. And probably our friend is aware of one book which has come out on that. I think edited by Herman Kulke. Maybe he must have seen that book. Nagapattinam was an important place because there is a title of the book, Nagapattinam to Swarnadweep. And several ideas are to be imagined there. First, idea number one. The Chola expansion is attested. The person who first brought it was George W. Spencer. He might recall. Now, how did the Chola Empire expand beyond the sea? You know, that's an important question. How did it go to Java? How did it go to Sumatra? So that is the kind of a question. So was it a conquest? Did Chola have a navy? If Buttonstein can question on Chola army, standing army, did Chola have an... I think there is one paper on Chola navy. So whether it was the navy of the Cholas or it was the navy of any one of the guilds or people who had to safeguard themselves in 13th century, there is a lot of things. So it is not settled that way. But what is real is that Southeast Asia trade, yes. Indian Ocean trade also was coming up. I think Noboru Karashima, I thought I will speak, when I speak about him, I will have all his works. So the Chola expansion is brought in as loot in Spencer's work. But it can be studied as trade also. Kenneth Hall, all these things, you know, that it has brought in the trade context, definitely, yes. But specific questions of navy, army, etc., has to wait for more evidence. I don't want to dismiss it. Yes, there is a lot of scope for research on that, provided there are sources permit you. We are at the mercy of sources. We know, there is no doubt about it. We have to have information. We have to verify the information, putting it to historical method. If some corroboration from here and there comes, we accept it as a fact. So that we cannot compromise. I am still again telling you, if we don't use the source, I swear by Professor R. S. Sharma, the historian will lose his identity.
Yes. So we'll take one last question for the evening. This is from Ambassador TCA Raghavan, sir, and his question is, Professor, can you shed some light on whether there have been wider cross-regional comparisons between Vijayanagar and formations of Southeast Asia at the end of the first millennium, that is Hampi and Angkor?
I have not come across any such work. I'm sorry. Maybe they are there. Sorry, I have not been able to read any of them if they are available. I'll be happy if it is brought to my notice.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking out time from your busy schedule to deliver this amazing and very enriching lecture with our audience. Thank you so much, sir, and we wish you a great year ahead, and we hope to see you again on this platform very soon.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I think I have taken 90 minutes, which is not generally done. Thank you for giving me this extra time and a very lovely interaction. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you very much, everybody who joined us live through Facebook and who will be watching this video on YouTube. Now you can join the YouTube channel as well. So go check it out. There are some perks like we are setting up a Karwan book club where we will be discussing history and politics and non-fiction books every month. We'll be having Zoom interactions with people across the world. So do check it out. I think that will be interesting for students as well as history buffs and readers. So thank you so much, sir. And we hope to see you soon. Have a great evening.
Thank you.